Aftermath of a Lengthy Rejection Slip by Charles Bukowski. I walked around outside and thought about it. It was the longest one I ever got. Usually the only said, "Sorry, this did not quite make the grade," or "Sorry, this didn't quite work in," or more often, the regular printed rejection form. But this was the longest ever. It was from my story, my adventures in 50 rooming houses. I walked under a lamppost, took the little slip out of my pocket and reread it. "Dear Mr. Bukowski, again, this is a conglomeration of extremely good stuff and other stuff, so full of idolized prostitutes, mourning after vomiting scenes, misanthropy, praise for suicide, etc., that it is not quite for a magazine of any circulation at all. This is, however, pretty much a saga of a certain type of person, and in it I think you've done an honest job. Possibly we will print you sometime, but I don't know exactly when. That depends on you. Sincerely yours, Whit Burnett." Oh, I knew the signature, the long H that twisted into the end of the W and the beginning of the B, which dropped halfway down the page. I put the slip back in my pocket and walked on down the street. I felt pretty good. Here I had only been writing 2 years, two short years. It took Hemingway 10 years, and Sherwood Anderson, he was 40, before he was published. I guess I would have to give up drinking and women of ill fame, though. Whiskey was hard to get anyhow, and wine was ruining my stomach. Millie, though, Millie, that would be harder, much harder. But Millie, Millie, we must remember art. Dostoevsky, Gorky for Russia, and now America wants an Eastern European. America is tired of Browns and Smiths. The Browns and the Smiths are good writers, but there are too many of them, and they all write alike. America wants the fuzzy blackness, impractical meditations and repressed desires of an Eastern European. Millie, Millie, your figure is just right. It pours down tight to the hips, and loving you is as easy as putting on a pair of gloves in zero weather. Your room is always warm and cheerful, and you have record albums and cheese sandwiches that I like. And Millie, your cat, remember? Remember when it was a kitten? I tried to teach him to shake hands and to roll over, and you said a cat wasn't a dog and it couldn't be done. Well, I did it, didn't I, Millie? The cat's big now. He's been a mother and had kittens. We've been friends a long time. But it's going to have to go now, Millie. Cats and figures and Tchaikovsky's Sixth Symphony. America needs an Eastern European. I found I was in front of my rooming house by then, and I started to go in. Then I saw a light on in my window. I looked in. Carson and Shipkey were at the table with somebody I didn't know. They were playing cards, and in the center sat a huge jug of wine. Carson and Shipkey were painters who couldn't make up their minds whether to paint like Salvatore Dali or Rockwell Kent, and they worked at the shipyards while trying to decide. Then I saw a man sitting very quietly on the edge of my bed. He had a mustache and a goatee, and looked familiar. I seemed to remember his face. I had seen it in a book, a newspaper, a movie, maybe. I wondered. Then I remembered. When I remembered, I didn't know whether to go in or not. After all, what did one say? How did one act? With a man like that, it was hard. He had to be careful not to say the wrong words. He had to be careful about everything. I decided to walk around the block once first. I read someplace that it helped when you were nervous. I heard Shipkey swearing as I left, and I heard somebody drop a glass. That wouldn't help me any. I decided to make up my speech ahead of time. Really, I'm not a very good speaker at all. I'm very withdrawn and tense. I save it all and put it in words on paper. I'm sure you'll be disappointed in me, but it's the way I've always been. I thought that would do it, and when I finished my block's walk, I went right into my room. I could see that Carson and Shipkey were rather drunk, and I knew they wouldn't help me any. The little card player they had brought with them was also bad off, except he had all the money on his side of the table. The man with the goatee got up off the bed. "How do you do, sir?" he asked. "Fine. And you?" I shook hands with him. "I hope you haven't been waiting too long," I said. "Oh, no. Really," I said, "I'm not a very good speaker at all. Except when he's drunk, then he yells his head off. Sometimes he goes to the square and lectures, and if nobody listens to him, he talks to the birds," said Shipkey. The man with the goatee grinned. He had a marvellous grin. Evidently a man of understanding. The other two went on playing cards, but Shipkey turned his chair around and watched us. "I'm very withdrawn and tense," I continued, "and past tense or circus tense," yelled Shipkey. That was very bad, but the man with the goatee smiled again, and I felt better. I save it all and put it in words on paper, and "nine-tenths or pretense," yelled Shipkey. "And I'm sure you'll be disappointed in me, but that's the way I've always been." "Listen, mister," yelled Shipkey, wobbling back and forth in his chair. "Listen, you with the goatee." "Yes?" "Listen, I'm 6 feet tall, with wavy hair and a glass eye and a pair of red dice." The man laughed. "You don't believe me, then? You don't believe I have a pair of red dice?" Shipkey, when intoxicated, always wanted, for some reason, to make people believe he had a glass eye. He would point to one eye or the other and maintain it was a glass eye. He claimed the glass eye was made for him by his father, the greatest specialist in the world, who had, unfortunately, been killed by a tiger in China. Suddenly, Carson began yelling, "I saw you take that card. Where did you get it? Give it here. Here. Marked. Marked. I thought so. No wonder you've been winning. So, so." Carson rose up and grabbed the little card player by the tie and pulled up on it. Carson was blue in the face with anger, and the little card player began to turn red as Carson pulled up on the tie. "What's up, huh? Huh? What's up? What's going on?" yelled Shipkey. "Let me see, huh? Give me the dope." Carson was all blue and could hardly speak. He hissed the words out of his lips with a great effort and held up on the tie. The little card player began to flop his arms about like a great octopus brought to the surface. "He crossed us," hissed Carson. "Crossed us." Pulled one from under his sleeve. "Sure as the Lord. Crossed us, I tell you." Shipkey walked behind the little card player and grabbed him by the hair and yanked his head back and forth. Carson remained at the tie. "Did you cross us, huh? Did you? Speak, speak," yelled Shipkey, pulling at the hair. The little card player didn't speak. He just flopped his arms and began to sweat. "I'll take you someplace where we can get a beer and something to eat," I said to the man with the goatee. "Come on, talk, give out. You can't cross us." "Oh, that won't be necessary," said the man with the goatee. "Rats, louse, fish-faced pig." "I insist," I said. "Rob a man with a glass eye, will you? I'll show you, fish-faced pig." "That's very kind of you, and I am a little hungry, thanks," said the man with the goatee. "Speak, speak, fish-faced pig. If you don't speak in 2 minutes, in just 2 minutes, I'll cut your heart out for a doorknob." "Let's leave right away," I said. "All right," said the man with the goatee. All the eating places were closed at that time of night, and it was a long ride into town. I couldn't take him back to my room, so I had to take a chance on Millie. She always had plenty of food. At any rate, she always had cheese. I was right. She made us cheese sandwiches and coffee. The cat knew me and leapt into my lap. I put the cat on the floor. "Watch, Mr. Burnett," I said. "Shake hands," I said to the cat. "Shake hands." The cat just sat there. "That's funny. It always used to do it," I said. "Shake hands." I remembered Shipkey had told Mr. Burnett that I talked to birds. "Come on now, shake hands." I began to feel foolish. "Come on, shake hands." I put my head right down by the cat's head and put everything I had into it. "Shake hands." The cat just sat there. I went back to my chair and picked up my cheese sandwich. Cats are funny animals, Mr. Burnett. You never can tell. Millie put on Tchaikovsky's Sixth for Mr. Burnett. We listened to the music. Millie came over and sat in my lap. She just had on a negligee. She dropped down against me. I put my sandwich to the side. I want you to notice, I said to Mr. Burnett, the section which brings forth the marching movement in this symphony. I think it's one of the most beautiful movements in all music. And besides its beauty and force, its structure is perfect. You can feel intelligence at work. The cat jumped up into the lap of the man with the goatee. Milly laid her cheek against mine, put a hand on my chest. Where you been, baby boy? Milly's missed you, you know. The record ended, and the man with the goatee took the cat off his lap, got up, and turned the record over. He should have found record number 2 in the album. By turning it over, we would get the climax rather early. I didn't say anything, though, and we listened to it end. How did you like it? I asked. Fine, just fine. He had the cat on the floor. Shake hands, he said to the cat. The cat shook hands.